Salon and Day Spa, located at 41 West Main Street in Northeast Pennsylvania, proudly supports Chautauqua Sunrise and its volunteers. More information at bellasalonanddayspa.net. Westfield Memorial Hospital provides high-quality health care to residents of Western New York, offering patients the most sophisticated medical advancements while keeping the ease and familiarity of a community hospital. Support for Chautauqua Sunrise has been provided by WRFA 107.9 FM, Jamestown's public radio station, streaming online 24/7 at WRFALP.com. Low power to the people. Funding is provided by a grant from New York State Senator Catherine M. Young, representing Western New York's 57th District with a local office in Olean. Chautauqua Sunrise is made possible by a grant from Fredonia Place, a continuing care retirement community providing dignity in a modern luxury environment. Meter's Restaurant, a family tradition for over 50 years in downtown Ripley, is a proud supporter of Chautauqua Sunrise. Meter's provides all-day dining, banquet services, and custom catering, specializing in pie. From the Access Channel 5 studios in Mayville, it's Chautauqua Sunrise. Chautauqua Sunrise is hosted by Doc Hamels and supported by the award-winning volunteers at Access Channel 5. Continuing the traditions of Senior Report, we are here to share local news, colorful interviews, and events of interest to everyone. Chautauqua Sunrise is broadcast live Saturday mornings each week, countywide, from 9 to 10 a.m. Join us by calling in live, emailing us, or checking out our social media. And now, from the Channel 5 studios, it's Chautauqua Sunrise.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Doc Hamels, and welcome to Chautauqua Sunrise. It's kind of a nice Saturday morning. I see the sun's trying to peek out for a change. But I got to caution you, I was reading just before we went on the air that we got a potential storm coming tomorrow afternoon through Monday afternoon. It's been crazy winter, hasn't it? It seems like we have 3 days of terrible weather, then we have a week and a half of okay weather, then another blast of something. And as I said a couple shows ago, I haven't put any of my clothes away for any season except my sandals. And other than that, I've been in and out of every type of weather clothing that you can possibly have, I think, over the winter. It's just been wild. I've talked to my son down in Florida, and he reported one day that they had a high of like 45 degrees, and we were at like 35 degrees that day. So, I mean, it's just interesting weather patterns. So enough with that. For those of you who are just joining us for the first time, welcome. The show here, we primarily focus on all the good stuff in Chautauqua County. And today is with no exception. We're going to be talking about quality child care and early childhood education. There we got it. Too early as always. They're laughing here. I told them I was going to do this. I want to also welcome the folks at WRFA 107.9, low power to the people, on Tuesdays at 1 o'clock. I just listened to it myself. You can go to an app on your computers, on your iPhones, and you can download WRFA 107.9 as an app. You can pop it up anytime you want, and they're live streaming. So I was listening to the entire Infinity show sitting in my house the other day by the fireplace, and I listened to the musicians and our singer and the saxophone players. It was fabulous, and the sound quality was excellent. So I offer that to you if you have nothing better to do and you want to listen to some really cool programming from all over the country. They have all kinds of neat stuff, and they have local things as well. WRFA, download the app. So I salute you guys. So Tuesdays at 1 o'clock, this show is rebroadcast, and we're so grateful to you that they share our information as well. I always try to find something interesting to talk about. So this morning, I double-checked my information because there's lots of alternative information out there these days. And there's my little slam there. And this is National Take Your Guitar Out Day. Who knew? Well, as many of you know, I'm a musician, and so I thought that was kind of interesting. So I thought about it for a minute, and I was going to bring it in, but I decided against it because it's pretty messed up. But my parents gave me my first guitar 50 years ago, and it has gone through every possible scenario. I think it's been kicked, stepped on, the dog has probably jumped on it, kids played it in school. But that first guitar is what really rocketed me into the music world. And it was right around when the Beatles were famous and all that good stuff. And for those of you that are out there that have those guitars in the closet, under the bed, hanging on the wall, get out, have a strum. It's a lifelong fun thing to do, and it's a good skill, and I encourage you to do that. And why I'm mentioning it is because on March 3rd, and I may talk about it here, I don't think I am. No, it's not listed, but on March 3rd at Infinity, Will Russell, my musical partner, and I will be hosting Doc and Willie's Acoustic Cafe at Infinity on March 3rd, and we're going to be inviting those of you that have those guitars that are they've been sitting in the corner all this time, or those that are active musicians, to join the students at Infinity and the guitarist and so forth. And if you're a violinist or if you have any other string instrument, we're going to welcome you. It's going to be sort of like a open mic kind of a thing, sort of a community get together, but it'll be a lot of fun, and we'll talk more about it down the road as we get closer. But anyways, Take Out Your Guitar Day is today, February 11th. Who knew? Okay, I have a bunch of announcements to share with you, so let's get started. And speaking of Infinity, they got a bunch of stuff as always. And if you missed the show last week, I'm telling you, that was something. We just had so much fun here, and they stretched the studio and stretched our staff here. We had microphones all over the place. Great fun. Such great talent. And it kind of goes hand in hand what we're going to be talking about with early childhood education. This is early kid music and arts and fine arts and developing that whole side of the brain. And it's a great opportunity for our children in Chautauqua County. And as Shane Hawkins mentioned, they work with 33 different school districts. That's pretty phenomenal. So let's get into it. The Affinity Visual Performing Arts Center will hold a new student orientation intake session on Thursday, this coming Thursday, February 16th. Orientation lasts approximately 30 minutes, including a tour of the Infinity Center and opportunities to meet with Infinity staff members and schedule lessons. Infinity Visual Performing Arts will be hosting also a dance and theater performance for students on February 17th, that'll be Friday at 7 p.m., in the Infinity Arts Cafe. Dance students will perform under the direction of Mariah Melendi, and theater students will perform under the direction of Adam Owens, Jamie Lee Bonfiglio Davis, ooh, there's a lot of names there, and Teal Weatherly. Also, they're looking forward to a spring full of fun and creative learning experiences for Chautauqua County. The Infinity Center will offer 2 weeks of hands-on spring break day camp activities for students age 5 to 12. Available camps include, and we talked about these last week a little bit, the first one is called Time Traveler, ages 5 through 12. Take a journey through time and explore a variety of different years and time periods through music, art, dance, theater, and literature activities and experiences. February 21 through 24, 9 a.m. to 4 p.m., price is $125. You know, going back to music again, in my own musical career, it's so interesting to look at the origins of a lot of the songs that I've done over the years, and lots of them are old folk songs that go back to like medieval times that were modernized and updated and changed and twisted and went from country to country. So a lot of the music we play is hundreds of years old, and other stuff is, you know, just came out this year. So it's interesting to see how music is morphed throughout the years. Spring into Music and Arts, ages 5 through 12. Have you ever wanted to try your hand at all different types of art, music, film, and theater? Infinity's Spring into Music and Arts Camp will allow you to make amazing art, film a movie, join a band, explore instruments, and perform a skit. So on day one, you can do upcycled art. Day two is lights, camera, action. They can work here if they want. Day three, instrumental exploration. Day four, break a leg. And that all takes place April 10 through 13. 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. and again $125. Okay, now, I finally got this figured out. I've been talking about this, but I really wasn't exactly sure how it worked. Okay, let's pop up that poster, Jeff. This is the Mayville Chautauqua Community Chamber of Commerce poster. While they're doing that, I'll start talking. They're going to have their festival logo scavenger hunt. Still waiting for them. That's me, right? But we need to pop up the poster here. Okay, what you do is you come into Mayville, and there we go. That's going to be happening starting, let's see here, through the 20th. Yeah, it started already, and it's all the way through the 28th. What you do is you go to all the various shops here in Mayville, and they have a code on their store window or in their doorway, and you mark that code down on an entry blank. You go through all the various places, and when it's all filled up, then you hand in your entry form, and then they're going to have a drawing for a big prize. Okay? Now, for more information, you go to chautauquachamber.org, and or you can contact the Mayville Chautauqua Chamber or the Chamber of Commerce Facebook pages and so on, and they'll explain more. The participating businesses are Webb's Candies, yum yum, Webb's Cottage Collection, Lighthouse Point Grocery, Three Seas Recreation, Crosby's, Mayville Hardware, Reverie Creamery, and Chautauqua Miniatures. So they're all part of this, so you got to get the code, put it down on your form, hand in the form, and then they're going to have some prize drawings when it's all done. Okay? So that's what's going on as part of the Winter Festival. Let's go to Westfield. Great things are happening at the Grape Discovery Center in Westfield. Come and visit and enjoy our exhibit room, tasting bar, and retail shop. There's never an admission fee. Located in Westfield at 8305 West Main on Route 20. And for the locals, that's the old Ford dealership. The Grape Discovery Center promotes the wine and grape industry in this region. Huge, huge industry. The Grape Discovery Center now has farm winery licensure, meaning they can now sell wine. Three Thursday evening events are scheduled, beginning February 16th, as Bob Green of the Mercyhurst Wine and Culinary Institute conducts a tasting series for wine, spirits, and craft beer. Mark your calendar for March 24th, which is called the Grape Discovery Center Wine and Culinary Dinner Experience, with pairings from the tasting series. That's a long title. In other words, they're going to have wine and food, and they're going to show you how to put certain wines and foods together. Hosting a small get-together, book our tasting room and outdoor patio when it gets warmer, overlooking the vineyards, for a small donation to the center. The room will accommodate up to 45 people. It's a beautiful center there, or building. If you haven't been there, just check it out. It's free. And if you have any questions, give my buddy Christina McCain, the manager over there, call at 326-2003 or go to their Facebook, facebook.com/ Grape Discovery Center, all one word. Okay, getting back to Mabel, just a reminder, not this weekend, but the following weekend. It's back up again. There it is. President's Day Weekend Festival. It's going to include the following. Contests, craft and food vendors, carriage rides, bonfire, scavenger hunt, fireworks, and much, much more. Fun for the whole family. It runs Saturday, 10 a.m., right after the show on for Saturday. You can buzz over there till 9 in the evening. Sunday, 11 a.m. to 4 p.m., fireworks, Randy's favorite. Saturday evening at 8 p.m. For more information, call the Chamber at 753-3113. Okay, there's page 1 and 2 done. Let's go on. Okay, my buddies over at St. Susan's. They have a soup and a song on Saturday, February 25, done on Water Street, 31 Water Street, Jamestown, from 6 to 8 p.m. This is way cool, especially for the winter months. St. Susan Center will once again host a soup and song, a program combining music by popular local groups and a great dinner. For the modest admission price of only $10 per guest, they'll be treated not only to an evening of live musical entertainment, but a meal consisting of specialty soups created by the staff at St. Susan Center. Guests will have the choice of 5 different specialty soups, good time of the year, as well as bread, desserts, and beverages. This is my kind of supper. The evening's entertainment will be Dave Muller and Gary Cuckler of Steel Rails. Tickets are available at the door. And ta-da-da, mark your calendar for Saturday, March 25th. You don't know this, do you? The next Soup in a Song will be yours truly, Doc Hamels and Will Russell, and we'll be providing the entertainment that night. So that's March 25, and we're excited about doing that as well. And we'll be bringing our brand of music to that event. All right, let's go up to Dunkirk. The Northern Chautauqua Community Foundation is offering a grant writing workshop on Thursday, March 9, from 2 to 3. Dr. Paul Benson will conduct the workshop at the Fredonia Technology Incubator at 214 Central Avenue, Dunkirk. Now, this is important. I've talked about this before. This workshop will include a discussion on the mechanics of writing a grant proposal. There's a way to write a proposal, and there's a way that you will not get money. So learn the way to get the money, because it's a certain process that you want to use. Ways to identify funding sources, the importance of research to support applicants and applications, and the tailoring of proposals to specific audience interest. Audience meaning the people that send out these requests, and they're the ones that read it. Participants are encouraged to bring questions in their particular grant writing challenges for discussion. Paul Benson has worked in grant development for over 23 years. He's versed in editing, grant writing, project management, and here we go, philanthropic, too early in the morning, development with outcome-based experience. Registration is required as space is limited. For more information to register for this free training, please call Eileen Dunn at the Northern Chautauqua Community Foundation at 366-4892. And please do that by March 3rd. So that's really important to know about that sort of thing, because as I say, many of our towns, our organizations, our clubs, sometimes we need a little extra money to put together a project, and they're there to help. Okay, let's go to Westfield. My Rotary Club, they want you to know the Westfield Mayville Rotary Club is letting you know that they're inviting you to try to win a pot of gold a few days just before St. Patrick's Day. All who are interested can buy a chance to fatten their wallets. I don't write this stuff, remember. While helping a good cause, the Rotary Club of Westfield Mayville is sponsoring its Cash to Bash Polio raffle with a prize of $500. Tickets are only $5 each and are available now through March 7th. Only 400 tickets will be sold. The drawing of the raffle tickets will be held on March 14th during the Rotary Club's regular meeting, which is held at 5:15 at the Parkview Restaurant in Westfield. The winner may not be present to win, and the lucky recipient will be contacted after the drawing. Okay, and tickets may be obtained by contacting my good friend Pete Bills at 326-2227 or any Rotary Club member. That would be me. So if you need tickets, I have tickets. Trust me, I have tickets. Okay, veterans of Chautauqua County, listen up. As of February 27th, you'll be able to save a bunch of money on prescriptions through the VA healthcare. The VA is creating three tiers of co-pays. We've gone through this a number of times, but basically you have various levels that you have in your prescriptions. And they go, tier one is $5, tier two is $8, tier three is $11. And all traditional exemptions still apply. These changes only apply to veterans without service-connected disabilities. If you have any questions or want more information, don't sit there and say, I'll get to it. Give them a call, 661-8255 at the Jamestown office, or 268-6030, the Dunkirk office. If you're married to a veteran, you know that he's a rockhead. Make the call. If you're married to a veteran, she could be a rocket, because we have veterans both ways here, all genders. Don't think that this is like something special. This is for you guys. You earn this right. You earn this privilege. You earn this and whatever you want to call it. It's a good thing. Check it out. All right. I'm going to go up to Dunkirk now. Mentor Challenge. The P-TECH Western New York STEM College and Career Academy. That's a mouthful, is looking for mentors for students. Mentors see talented youth graduate from the P-TECH Academy and begin their lifelong careers here at and remain in Chautauqua County. They have a couple of hours each month to spend with a small group of students at the P-TECH Academy. They share professional guidance, wisdom, academic, and personal support to high school age students. For more information, give Michelle Starwell a call with the Striders Group at 3-6-3-2-2-0-3. Let me just see here what else we got. Okay. Then the Westfield Memorial Hospital has an interesting here report. This is from their foundation, and they are here to announce that the upcoming renovation of the emergency department is in full swing and has begun its $500,000 renovate our emergency department. That's the red campaign. Westfield Memorial Hospital is the closest community hospital to Chautauqua Institution. For many years, Westfield Memorial Hospital has operated Chautauqua Institution's primary care clinic on Roberts Avenue, serving the needs of countless Chautauquans, as well as everybody else in this area. With the emergency department upgrade slated to begin this winter and to continue into the spring, the foundation is inviting everyone to be a supporter of this incredible effort by joining the Red Campaign. For more information, give Patricia De Palma a call at the foundation office at 793-2388. And my last announcement is, I freestyle this one. For those that are 65 on up and household income is under $86,000 and you own a home, you are eligible for the enhanced STAR school tax property tax exemption. This is from Kathy Young to remind you that you have till March 1st to contact your local assessor's office if you are eligible for this exemption. Once again, this is something you are eligible for. It's not like a handout. It's there for you to partake, and if you don't, shame on you. Okay? So that's the enhanced STAR program. And right now, I'm going to take a breather. A lot of talking for me. I'm going to be quiet. We have a great public service announcement. So have a listen and have a look.
What is Quality Stars New York? To better answer that question, let's use our imagination. Imagine you're going on vacation. You need to choose a hotel. How do you decide? Simple. You look at the price and you look at the stars. No, not those stars. These stars. But the point is that we use this type of rating system to make a lot of decisions in our life. What restaurants to eat at, what movie to see, even what car to drive. But believe it or not, in New York State, there is no system for rating our early childhood programs. Well, until now. Introducing Quality Stars New York. This is a voluntary five-star rating system that not only helps parents make better choices, but will also help teachers to strengthen their programs, improve children's learning, and even help spur New York State's economic recovery. And best of all, it works. 24 other states have adopted similar rating systems and have achieved measurable results. New York State can't be left behind. In the next few minutes, you're going to hear from a few of a growing number of supporters on why New York State needs Quality Stars New York now.
My name is Khadija Tips, and I'm a working mother, so quality childcare is critical. My childcare search was an ordeal. I didn't know what to look for. I didn't know what constituted quality. I got put on wait lists. I got some callbacks, mostly not. A lot of my calls went unanswered. I visited places that were no longer in operation. Not having a rating system, I wasted time visiting centers that I never should have been at in the first place. If Quality Stars would have existed when I started my search, my whole journey would have been entirely different. It would have saved me time. I wouldn't have missed work. I would have had a good reference point where to start. It would have given me some information about what it is to look for. Quality, affordable childcare should not be a mission of epic proportions. New York needs Quality Stars now.
We know now that the first 5 years are so important because of the neuron connections that happen by the time a child's five. If those neuron connections are not made by the time a child's five, they're lost to that child forever. We actually first, when Quality Stars was announced, we first got involved with it because we wanted to know what was going on. We were not anticipating the kinds of things to come out of it that did. You know, they didn't just come in and say, okay, what's right and what's wrong. What they did is they came in and they said, okay, here's where your strengths are, here's where your areas that you could show improvement. And we were able to sit down with someone from Quality Stars, and together we collaborated our plan to make our program stronger. So in the infant toddler program, for example, we were able to make changes in the sensory experience for children. And so what the teachers saw because of that is that children were much more engaged. They were less disruptive. The teachers are coming to me nearly every day and saying, I love my job so much more. I can't believe the kind of learning I now am able to interject in my classroom. And it's just had incredible benefits, and we can see it on a daily basis. It changes for children.
There's lots of data, and the research is clear. For every dollar invested in early childhood education, we will see a return of between $4 and $7 in reduced remedial services and increased earnings. These are very tough economic times, and we're all making very deliberate choices about how to invest the resources we have to work with. This system works. It has been successful in many other states, and so we want to catch up and be as competitive as those other states. This is a critical investment to ensure that we build a foundation for our children, that we build a foundation for our system, and that the state builds a foundation for its economic sustainability over time.
Children are a most valuable resource, and Quality Stars New York will make sure we're giving them and those who care for them the best chances for success. To learn more and to help make sure Quality Stars becomes available for all children in New York State, visit www.winningbeginningny.org.
Very cool. When I watched those little kiddos, I was thinking of how much fun I had raising my children, my wife and I, and all the crazy things. And then I got to do it all over again with my one granddaughter, who for some reason thinks that we should do makeup together. So there's some wild pictures of us with all kinds of fun things and good stuff. Okay, about 7 months ago, back in September, we did a show here with Joanne Homiser and Beth Starks, and we were talking about child care and quality stuff and, you know, what was going on here in Chautauqua County. And after that show, I tracked how many people viewed it on YouTube. And she may not know this, she's in the studio right now here with me. But this particular show was the most watched show of Chautauqua Sunrise to date. Now, who would have thought 260 times someone would have watched that show in a very short period of time? It was like within 2 weeks. So that to me was incredible. And when she asked me if she wanted to could come back on and talk about something called Quality Stars, and that she was going to bring a very well-known college professor with her, I said, absolutely, let's do it. So right now I want to welcome back Beth Starks. You are the guru and the queen of Chautauqua Lake Child Care Center, just down the road.
Yes.
And you have today Dr. Mira Berkley. I said it right.
You did.
Because I grew up with Myras in my neighborhood. But Mira, and you are, from what I read, you were let me get this right, Associate Professor Emeritus.
Yes.
That's pretty cool. I don't have that after me. I don't have that. At Fredonia State College.
Yes.
So welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
So what in the world would cause 260 people to watch a show on childcare? To me, that speaks volumes. It does. Because we've done so many different types of shows here. And I hope they're not listening, but when I have people like in political office, I get like 18 views. I mean, seriously. But I was astounded by that. So that tells me this is an important topic. So, Beth, why are you here, and what are we going to talk about today? Because you asked me to come on to talk about this.
Yes. Quality childcare is important to all of us as a society. It's really important as the basis of our economic development in Chautauqua County. And so that may not make sense to everyone, but I wanted to talk about that today.
Okay.
So when we came on talking about the childcare center and the success of my childcare center, we talked a little bit about the fact that it's high quality and why that's important. And that's probably why there was so much popularity with that video is that my child care center has touched a lot of families.
Do you realize no matter how many times your mother watched that show, it only counts as one?
So it wasn't
260 times a mom watching
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
So it's a pervasive concern because
yes.
it's not just babysitting. It's huge to that, to this topic.
And that high quality care and education is important for so many reasons. So it touches the lives of those children who are future citizens of this county, and we want to touch their lives in so many different ways. But it also is each of the child care centers and in-home facilities is in and of itself a small business. And so that's over 100 small businesses in this county. And then in addition to all of the people working for those centers and all of the people employed in the industry, everyone else that is going to work that has young children needs some sort of child care for those children. And so they could not go to their jobs and essentially support the rest of the workforce in the county if they did not have child care.
The 1940s and 50s are gone.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Both parents are working, if possible. I mean, that's the name of the game. That's the reality. And so we need child care. Now, my understanding is there's licensed, unlicensed, there's child care centers, there's Head Start, church groups have daycare kind of things. Have I covered everything that's out there? Are there other versions of child care?
Well, most recently there's pre-K, which is sometimes in a child care center and sometimes in a public school. Mm-hmm. And so our early care and education has kind of taken a different shift in that some of it is now within public schools as well.
So. Okay. So let's get Mira involved with the discussion here. So what's your background, Mira?
Well, I've worked in the field of early childhood education for over 40 years. And
you started at 15?
Right, exactly, yes. Yeah, it doesn't actually count all that babysitting.
That's true.
But so you had mentioned my title as being emeritus from SUNY Fredonia. So that was, I worked there for 15 years, and before that I worked at JCC for 9 years, and before that I worked with young children for 15 years. But I'm actually wearing another hat now, and that is as the quality improvement specialist for Quality Stars New York. So I am continuing to work in the field, but retired from what I thought was. and so I've done a lot of work actually with young children in different programs, including in Chautauqua County. Many years ago, I worked in Head Start, and I worked as a kindergarten teacher many years ago. God.
So you've really been in the business in the field.
A long time, and most of it, though, in teacher education.
But you know, working that many years with little kids, you don't look that tired. My grandkids will come over, and I'm pooped after like 20 minutes, and go see Grandma. It's just so much fun, though. Okay, so... we talked a little bit about the importance of child care. We touched on it a little bit and how it's economically important to our community. But what's this Quality Stars? What's that all about and where did it come from? And we can bounce this around between you.
Well, you brought it to the county really bad.
Quality Stars New York is a quality rating and improvement system. Every other state in the country, or the majority of them, had some sort of quality rating and improvement system. New York State is behind in this. So a group of early childhood advocates wanted to bring it to New York State. The problem is there was no funding behind it.
Right, but where did it come from to begin with? Is there an origin to this?
One of the things, I don't know specifically, but I do know that in our field, there's been a lot of research that supports best practices for young children that have been overlooked in the implementation of programs.
Okay.
And this really brought a lot of players together who are involved in early childhood in different arenas so that we have people like from state ed as well as from the social services area of things, and then other advocacy groups, right? So we have the consortium. But what it does is it brings together the research that's been out there for a long, long time and has really pulled it together in a way that can guide and help programs to make improvements.
I don't think 30 years ago you would hear those two terms together, child care and research. Mm-hmm. I don't think people really would associate. You just take the kids, you drop them off, and you go to work.
Well, 30 years ago, it was out there, but it was only a few of us were paying attention, and with our best efforts
screaming to try into the wind, you know, it's important. So why is it important to have Quality Stars or a rating system, Beth?
Well, because I think that there's a big misunderstanding about what quality is, and that some people, as the woman in the video that you saw, don't, as parents, don't know what to look for, whether they're well-educated parents or not. It's hard to know when you are trusting someone with your child where to take them and what things to look for. But in addition to that, there is so much research that proves, you saw that statistic, if we invest $1 in early care and learning, that it can have an investment of, they say, up to $11. And so, and that's reduced remedial costs, the reduced costs of prison, juvenile justice, and more successful members of society. So if we're going to make this investment, though, the one critical piece is that it has to be high quality. So it can't just be any program. It has to be a good program. That's where you'll see the difference. So it's not, if I just put my child in any care anywhere, that then they'll be better off in life. It has to be good. And so what is good? We have to define that, and we have to all have a common definition of high quality.
Let's hold that thought for a minute, because I want to go back to Mira here for a second. So 30 years ago, you said people really weren't paying attention to this. Now they are. So how do you know that what Beth is talking about is true?
Well, there's a body of research that's out there. Okay. And it's very compelling, and certain people have paid a lot of attention to it, but then in implementation, it's been another story. But we have economists who are, you know, paying close attention to this, mm-hmm. Who are, you know, why aren't we making this kind of an investment? And I think it is just that people are not willing to wait as long as it takes to really see some of the benefits of this. And people want to find an easy way out, because the high quality programs require staff who are well trained, who are paid well, and those things have not gone together in the world of children who are 0 to 5 years old.
Okay, because Beth alluded to the video of $1.
Yes.
And it's a return of $11. So this would take a longitudinal study, a mm-hmm. long time to determine this.
Yeah.
So that obviously
they have,
this has
they're
been
absolutely.
Done.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's been done.
One of the most interesting longitudinal studies actually tracked participants now for over 35 years, and that is amazing. And so they've tracked their lives. And it may seem remarkable to some people, and even that not true, that you could implement programming and have a child and their family involved in early, like before five, care and education, and that would have a remarkable difference in their lives, the rest of their lives. And so it's less of a chance for them to need remedial services in school. That probably makes sense to you with mm-hmm. your background in
right.
school. But then you take it a step further, that there's less of a chance that there will be youth that are incarcerated or in prison later on, that there's less of a chance that we would need to spend money on public services, because there's a greater chance that they'll get a job and be a contributing member of society.
And then it's all connected.
It's all,
yes,
connected.
It's all connected.
And then you take it 35 years out, and those same participants actually had better health benefits. So they had less of heart, is it? I can't remember the exact, but it was heart disease and mm-hmm. And health issues. So they're healthier.
Nutrition.
Right. And so that's less money that we're all collectively paying on, you know, on health insurance and medical programs.
This runs, and I know it has nothing to do with what you're talking about, but it runs parallel to what I've discussed in the past about people. And then I'm going to offend somebody. I know I'm going to do that. So suck it up, because I'm going to offend you. But smokers, we say if you don't smoke, you are not going to be a financial burden on your family because of disease and other things down the road. And I lost a very dear friend of mine to lung cancer, and the pain and agony he went through, the cost to the family, the insurance, the medical expenses, all that stuff, if he had never put the cigarette in his mouth. Let's flip it around. If we invest in kids when they're young, they're going to have such a better start and good stuff. What would happen if we didn't have that?
What would happen is what's happening now, right?
What is happening?
So our drug epidemic in this county,
mm-hmm.
the number of youth that are incarcerated, the number of babies born addicted to drugs. I mean, I could go on and on. We all watch the news. We know what's going on in our society right now, and it's not good. It's scary. But I think that we can change it all together. We can.
Okay, so I said I was going to get back to you, and what the question is, you were just saying we need to define good. So in this case, we need to define quality. So correct. What is quality child care?
Go ahead, Mira.
Oh,
that was slick.
Well, the way Quality Stars has put it together is looking at four key areas of what would be a quality early childhood program. And they've looked at a lot of indicators, but the big categories are the learning environment. So what is in the learning environment? How is it arranged? What's happening there? What are we doing? Where the children actually go? But in addition to that, we have to take into consideration, for it to be high quality, management and leadership that recognizes how do you work with a program like that. What about the staff qualifications and experiences? So we know that if you're going to be a teacher in a public school, you have to have certification, but you can work in a childcare center with nothing. And so and some of those folks do a fine job, but that's not the way that we expect to find quality providers of care and education for young children. And then the fourth big category is family engagement. So how is the family engaged with the program? So those are the big categories. Do you want to?
Well, let me jump in a little bit. When you talk about staff qualifications and training and certification and all that, one of my lives was I was a training specialist through BOCES, and I worked with a variety of different groups of people within the school system. And I'm not going to pick on any particular group, but let's just say they were a group of people I had to work with that were not typically your certified staff, but they were non-certified staff. But they dealt with kids, okay? And we would talk about discipline or positive reinforcement and things like that, and they just kind of looked at me like glazed over, like, what are you talking about? And I would try to have them understand that what your mom and dad did when you were kids doesn't necessarily apply when you're in school, so you can't cuff them off the back of the head or use foul language. And I'm making things up, but these were true stories. Or, you know, scream at them and things like that, because that's not necessarily the outcome that you're looking for when you're working with kids. So we had to change behavior. But if you are working with quality child care, you have to invest, I would assume, in training.
Correct.
Yeah. Everybody.
Yes.
And as you said, there was a time and place where whoever was in charge of the children didn't have that training, right?
So one of the benefits to programs that are participating in Quality Stars is there are funds to help to support professional development that would not be available to these individuals probably otherwise to be able
so
to support.
So since your group, your child care center signed up for Quality Star, did you volunteer for this?
Yes, so it is voluntary and it's free. So you do not have to pay for it at all. And then in addition, there are benefits like additional training for your staff, additional supplies and materials for your center, and the support of Dr. Berkley to come in and help you through the process.
Help us. So you actually are drawing down funds through this program. And who funds it?
It's funded by New York State. So Governor Cuomo put it in initially $3 million, and then went up to $5 million for this current fiscal year. Mm-hmm. His proposal for next year just keeps it at $5 million. So the unfortunate thing is that it's not funded across the state. Started as a pilot funding through private dollars, and then finally got into the state budget. But in other states, it is publicly funded. And through full implementation, done the right way, and really supporting centers, supporting families as well. There's a family component to support that parent who's looking for quality and needs to know what to look for. In other states, there's tax incentives. So if you go to a higher quality facility, that you would get a better tax benefit and more dollars to help pay for it all. That piece is missing, but we're getting there. It's progress, and we were lucky enough to have it here in Chautauqua County. So
it came to Chautauqua County almost a year and a half ago.
So it's relatively new.
It's relatively new. It was actually October of 2015 when it came to Chautauqua County, which was nice timing for me as I was ready to move into. And for me, it's actually part-time. So it's only part-time in Chautauqua County. Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm actually working with 19 different sites.
You said you're retired?
Yeah.
And this is part-time. What am I missing?
Sort of. 19 so sites. At this point, sort of. I mean, it's a little misleading because in a couple of cases, there's one one program that's oversees three sites, for instance.
Okay. And
but the sites include, in Chautauqua County now, both North and South County, working with child care centers and family daycare providers.
Wonderful.
And now we just are working with the three PK expansion programs that are in Dunkirk. So, and that includes now the first Head Start program that I'll be working with.
Okay.
And so these programs are at different stages in the process of participating in Quality Stars, but we've been able to get in there and help. But getting back to like the qualifications and the training, you know, different programs have different requirements at this point. But what we're able to do is with Quality Stars is to really look at where people are and to help them take the steps they're ready to take to build on their strengths. And so everybody isn't going to be at the same place at all, but we're there to help to support the programs work together to help them make those steps that keep moving them up towards improved quality.
Okay, take a breath. Folks, you're watching Chautauqua Sunrise. I'm Doc Hamels, and my guests today are Beth Starks from Chautauqua Lake Child Care Center and Dr. Mira Berkley, Emeritus Professor, who is working as, what's your title, consultant?
Quality Improvement Specialist.
That thing. And we're talking about really Quality Stars. It's a rating system of determining quality child care services for your child in Chautauqua County. Last night, while my wife was watching reruns of MASH, which I've seen 10 times now, I brought up Quality Stars, and on my iPad, it was like trying to pull up a 40-foot ladder, because I was looking at all the ratings, and it went on forever. And there we go. That's the website, if anybody's interested. It's QualityStars.New York.
QualityStarsNY.org.
And if you want to look more into that, you click the first little box there, and up comes everything you want to see as far as the ratings go. It's monumental. It's huge. Mm-hmm. You get 2 points if you have the right whatever. Or Beth, were you crazy? I mean, I'm serious. I mean, this was, there's like got to be like 500 different things there.
You're talking about the standards, aren't you?
Yeah.
And the standards inventory, yes.
That was huge.
And there are a lot of standards, but the truth is that it takes every one of those in order to really be the best program that you can be for young children. And so at any level, the great thing about it is that it is voluntary. There also is someone to help you through that mm-hmm. process. But it's also very self-reflective. And so it was our center going through the standards and looking one by one and then thinking about what do we do really, really well? And then where are areas that we could grow? And that's the same thing we do from our perspective in working with young children. We meet them where they are. So not here's all your faults or all the areas that you need to, we want to focus on. But yet, where are you? And what are the things you do really, really well? And then what are the areas that you want to grow in? And then let's think about how to use your strengths to grow in those other areas. And so even a high quality program can still find areas to grow.
Mm-hmm.
And a program that's just at the beginning and trying to figure out the definition of quality can figure that out.
So it's defined. This is what quality is if you look at these.
Yeah.
So are you doing this with the other 18 sites? This reflective process?
Yeah. Now I see them. I mean, it varies, but the expectation is that I will be on site about once every 4 to 6 weeks, which I haven't kind of established exactly if that's the way that works. For some, depending on where they are in the process, some it's been more, some it's been less.
Sure.
And they're, but it's very developmental, and I think that's really important. Because that's like the foundation of what makes high quality early childhood too. It's what makes for what those teachers need to be highly qualified is to really understand child development. And so the work that we do with children should be developmental based on the development of those children, and the work that we do with the programs is developmental. So where they are, so there's always a place where they have the strengths that they have and where they are right now, and then how do we help them to keep growing.
So if it's developmentally appropriate, we're talking about materials, the furniture, how we speak to them, how we their expectations, all that stuff has to be age appropriate, basically.
Yes, it's age appropriate, and then it's also individually appropriate. So sure. You know, you can have one group of 3-year-olds who in many ways look like another group of 3-year-olds, but there are going to be some things that you're going to be doing differently with this group because of who these children are versus, you know, who the other children are.
Sure. And that should be fundamental. And so I teach child development at Jamestown Community College, so that's my full-time job on the faculty there in the teacher education program. And you're required, so in my bachelor's degree, you're required that one course in child development. And really, that's not enough for teachers, because that should be at the heart of what we're learning.
I took that course at Buff State.
Right, yeah. But really, we need more than that. So no, we can understand all of the philosophies about teaching and about teaching particular subject areas, but we need to understand children at the heart of what we do, and focus on that being, if we make every decision about what's best for children and really understand what a child in this particular age group needs and what they're learning at that age and how to best help them at that particular age and the theories behind what we should be teaching them and how we should be teaching them and how to meet those individual needs, mm-hmm. like that would really help a teacher. To really help a teacher be the best teacher they can be.
And I would just say that traditionally, in the past, in early childhood teacher preparation, it was much more heavily based on child development. My own background, I was in a human development major, mm-hmm. and to become an early childhood teacher. So I had many courses at that formal education level that has been missing, really, from, you know, the current expectations. And so those are some of the kinds of things that we want to really help people with the additional professional development that they get, so that we have adults working with children who are really focused on understanding them developmentally.
I'm sitting here and I'm thinking, my viewers and listeners right now, what's the takeaway, as they often say? And so far I'm thinking the takeaway is that grandparents, parents, whomever are listening right now, they will want to begin to look at various centers, child care programs, and start asking questions of, are you a Quality Star program?
Yes.
And when they walk into, if they don't know that, when they walk into that center, that site, that they start to look for things that you're going to tell me what they should be looking for here in a second. And just as I was thinking, I forget to do this all the time. Folks, we still have about 6 minutes left. And if you do have a question for my guest, you can give us a call at 753-5225. But I get so engrossed in the topic, I forget that we also are calling. So, Beth, if we were going to visit a few sites for a child, a grandchild, my own child, the first area of quality you mentioned, I think Mira did, was a learning environment. So what is a quality learning environment look like?
When you walk into that center or home, whatever place that you're looking at, it's important that there's a checklist that I provide to families, whether they're looking at my center or an in-home facility, to really make that choice. Because I don't want anyone choosing my center because they have to, because it's their only option. That's the first most important thing, that parents need choice, and that we don't have enough high-quality options for parents, and so many feel like I have to take this person because that's all I can find right now, or that's all all I can afford. And so when you walk in, really knowing, first of all, being prepared on what do I look for? And then that feeling when you first walk into that home or that center or that school, that the feeling that you get, are you welcomed? Is it a place that you'd like to hang out all day every day? And is it a place where you think that you can trust them to take care of your most precious gift? And so that would be the beginning. And then as you walk into the classroom or into the home in whatever area they're taking care of the children, to look at how it's set up, and is it safe? So safety and health should be at the basis. So every licensed program in New York State, we can be sure that they're at least healthy and safe, and that should be a bare minimum for all children. So if the program's not licensed, I would be asking other questions to make sure basic things like, are the outlets covered? You know, that are they sanitizing and cleaning to keep children healthy? Are they feeding nutritious meals? That's all basic health and safety. But what you need to understand is then quality is one step above that. So some people think, well, it's licensed, it's good to go, right? Mm-hmm. That's the bare minimum.
That's
right?
Getting your foot in the door.
Yeah, and if places have multiple violations for health and safety issues, they're struggling just to keep that. And that is all public record. So when you are looking for a licensed facility, you can go on the website for the New York State Office of Children and Family Services. You can search by zip code and find the licensed facilities in the area. And you can see right there how many times they've been cited for how many violations and what they were. Mm-hmm. Most people don't even know that. And then you take that a step beyond, and then you're looking for other things once you get there.
But in today's day and age, everybody has an iPhone or iPad or a computer. Yeah. This is readily available.
Yes, it is. Okay. I think that most people just don't know that it is.
Yeah.
But if we get on into what we want to see in the higher quality programs, one thing about children in this age range is that they learn through play. And we need to see environments that support the way children learn through play, and that they're well-organized environments that give children the opportunity for exploration and discovery and social interaction. And it looks really different from what most people think of as school. But it's those sorts of environments that are really supporting these children so that they are going to be well prepared to be successful when they reach school age.
So we, in essence, are breaking the paradigm that early childhood is not early school,
right,
which is sitting at a desk and that sort of thing.
It's not that picture of school.
But I mean, people just, because they don't know better, they would just, well, we did it in kindergarten, we'll just bring it down. But that's not where kids are at developmentally.
And we need to be really careful. And I'm looking at the time that's going away, and I'm thinking maybe you need a program on play. Because that's
all the guys here with the cameras would love that. Zoom, 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 zoom. Okay. A question came up while we were talking, because people will ask questions. Mm-hmm. What about, and they said the child is left behind. So I'm assuming children that are in crisis or perhaps have a disability, how's that child fit into all this?
The great thing about high quality early care and learning and education is that we individualize so much that when that child is there, it would not matter if a child with special needs, that you recognize every culture and where children come from in their homes. You work in collaboration with those families and recognize that the parent is the primary teacher of that child. And so all of that goes together. And so every child should have their needs met where they are.
So again, the paradigm of the industrial model of education, of the factory where everybody stamps, bang, 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 we're all the same, you know, the assembly line mentality, it's gone.
Right.
All right. We have less than a minute left. I'll let you talk about what. How do we find out more information if a parent wants to know? Is there a contact that we can have them contact them? They can give them information?
Well, the best place to get more information about Quality Stars is the website.
Okay.
And then I'm trying to think, I guess, I mean, my contact number is 716-203-1728.
Okay.
If people want to find out, we are going to be doing recruitment in April. There are going to be two recruitment sessions for programs that are interested in applying for Quality Stars, and there will be some additional programs that are added to my caseload at that point. Mm-hmm.
Beth, you get last comment.
All right, so the last comment for me is for everyone working with young children to recognize how important it is with the newest brain research that our brains are being wired the first 5 years and especially the first 3 years. So what happens, every interaction, every conversation you have with that child, every time you hold them, pick them up, talk to them, read to them, makes a difference in the foundation of the rest of their lives.
Invest now because it's important for later. Thank you, ladies, for joining me today. Extremely important stuff, and I'm so glad you could share that with us. Folks, you've been watching Chautauqua Sunrise, and if you want to know more about early child education, talk to these ladies. Check it out. We'll see you all next time right here, 9 o'clock at Access 5. I'm Doc Hamels. Have a great weekend. Watch the weather. Thanks again.
Thank you.
And we cover what we can cover.